Science Uncut, presented by the Volkswagen Foundation.
What are the early origins of chronic inflammation? That is the question at the heart of Harald Renz's talk. Harald Renz is director of the Institute of Laboratory Medicine and Pathobiochemistry at the University of Marburg in Germany. Chronic inflammation plays an important role in autoimmune diseases, allergies, and asthma. Inflammation results from a combination of genetic and environmental factors, and over the past years, research has more and more stressed the crucial role of the environmental part, especially outside influences we are exposed to before we are born and shortly thereafter. For example, the number of animal species a pregnant woman has contact with directly correlates with a higher activation status of the immune system of the child. The so-called endotoxin exposure of a child before and after birth determines how protected it is against chronic inflammatory diseases. In his talk, Harald Renz explains how he and his research team tested immune responses in mice to endotoxin exposure. Renz gave his talk on October 10, 2014, at the Herrenhausen Conference, Beyond the Intestinal Microbiome, From Signatures to Therapy. The conference was organized by the Volkswagen Foundation and took place in Hanover, Germany. The title of the talk is Environmental Microbes in the Hygiene Hypothesis.
Now I have the privilege of introducing myself. I'm Harald Renz from Marburg, and I'm interested in chronic inflammation, and particularly the development, the early origin of inflammation, and the model diseases we are working on are shown here. This is a patient, a little kid, suffering from bronchial asthma. So we are now turning to the environmental perspective of microbial exposures. We have heard a lot about intrinsic microbes, microbes colonizing various mucosal surfaces, but also this is probably my main task to show you that also environmental exposures play a very important role in modifying these conditions. And the basic concept of how we currently understand the development of these diseases is shown on the top part of this slide. Chronic inflammation, chronic inflammatory diseases are eventually the result of a very complex interaction between a genetic composition on the right-hand side and environmental exposures. And you see here as an indicator for these environmental exposures, microbes, but also nutrition and other factors, stress, psychological issues play here a very important role. But today we will focus on these environmental bacteria. And when you talk to geneticists who are doing GWAS in this area and so on, they are now currently admitting that probably the contribution of the genetic makeup for the development of the phenotype might be maybe 20%, 20-25%. 80-75% of the makeup of the development of these clinical phenotypes is the result of environmental exposures. So at least from that point of view, it will be very important to further understand these microbial factors that are either risk factors or even protective factors. And now, just recently, another very important aspect comes into this field, and that is the recognition that are apparently certain windows of opportunities where our immune system seems to be highly vulnerable for such environmental exposures. And this is the pre- and postnatal environment. And we have heard already a couple of very interesting examples in this regard. Charles McKay gave us a wonderful introduction into this field just yesterday. Pre- and postnatal environment means not only the postnatal part, breastfeeding, we have discussed the importance of early nutrition in life, but also prenatal development. And I think this is one of the major, really exciting fields in this regard that we are now starting to better understand the impact of these maternal-fetal interactions in this regard and how these maternal-fetal interactions actually contribute to either disease development or to protection for the diseases. And in order to go and to move into this area, we need certain model situations which allow us to study these complex interactions. The development of these chronic inflammatory diseases in the field of allergy and asthma or autoimmunity eventually the result of a loss of clinical and immunological tolerance. So in order to understand this concept, on the one hand side, we need to learn about the mechanisms which lead to the development of tolerance, and then what is breaking this program, what is interrupting this program. And there are three major concepts currently discussed, which I will briefly introduce to you in this regard. The first concept is the hygiene hypothesis. This is the oldest concept in this context. The hygiene hypothesis is actually based on observations that we need a certain amount of natural infections, let's say, viral infections, bacterial infections, and again, particularly during the first few years of life, in order to mount a strong immune response, which leads to the development of tolerance. So, and if this is interrupted, then diseases like asthma, early childhood asthma, food allergies, or other conditions arise. And actually, there are a couple of examples coming from clinical and epidemiological studies, which show us that yes, there are certain individuals, certain environmental conditions, where we see less allergic diseases, less asthma. And these examples are listed here on this slide: having older siblings, frequent viral infections during the first few years of life, early daycare, anthroposophic lifestyle conditions. All of this is connected to protection, very significant protection. And one model situation where we are particularly interested in this regard is traditional farming. Traditional farming has been identified as a protective environmental situation already maybe 15, 20 years ago by Charlotte Braun-Fahrländer from Switzerland, from Basel, an epidemiologist who made this peculiar observation that living under these particular conditions is associated with a lower risk for allergies and asthma. And allergies and asthma are very interesting diseases, particularly in that regard, since these are the first chronic inflammatory conditions in life. They are coming first, within the first year, the first few years in life. All the other diseases, type 1 diabetes, chronic inflammatory bowel diseases, multiple sclerosis, and so on, they are coming much later, maybe decades later in life. So here, studying allergy and asthma allows us to connect early life events with the development of a clinical phenotype in a very small time window, very small time frame. And in this particular environment, of course, many factors are different from urban lifestyle conditions or from modern lifestyle conditions. But one factor is very important, and that is the microbial context in this regard. So what we would like to do is to establish the cause-effect relationship between these environmental exposures, in this case microbial exposures, and the development of the clinical phenotype down here with regard to the involvement of innate and adaptive and effector immune responses. And a starting point in this regard was the story about endotoxin. And this was probably the study which showed us, which demonstrated this relationship or this inverse relationship between the natural endotoxin exposures and these protective events in a very elegant fashion. So what we did in this study was we collected dust samples from mattresses and other environmental areas in these traditional farming environments. We measured the endotoxin load in these biosamples. And when the epidemiologists could adjust and correlate the individual endotoxin exposures, chronic endotoxin exposures, to the risk for the development of clinical phenotypes. I'm just showing here hay fever symptoms and atopic sensitizations, meaning basically the production of IgE antibodies against the allergens. And in all of these associations, we observe this inverse relationship, meaning as higher the natural exposure to endotoxin as a marker for gram-negative bacterial exposure in the environment is, as higher the dose, as better is the protective effect. And here we are talking about chronic exposures, lifelong exposures, basically. The measurements were done at an age of 5 to 7 to 10 years. Showed this very remarkable and very strong relationship. And this was actually, this chronic endotoxin exposure is actually associated with an upregulation of certain markers in the innate immune system, as shown here, for example, CD14 expression or expression of toll-like receptor 2 comparing pharma and non-pharma children. So we see this activation on the level of the innate immune system. And this activation occurs apparently in a dose-response fashion. In this study, which was performed a few years later, Ege and al. Correlated the number of animal species, these are the numbers here, the number of different animal, farm animal species the mother had contact to during pregnancy. So here now, again, we are moving into the prenatal environment. So these are prenatal exposures during pregnancies. And you can appreciate that as more different animal species the mother had contact to during pregnancy, as higher is the activation status of these innate immune response systems in the children, in the childhood, in the next generation. And this indicated for the first time that there is some kind of transmaternal transmission of signals from one generation to the other, which seems to confer this protective effect. Now, the starting point, as I mentioned, was the measuring of LPS, of endotoxin, as a marker of gram-negative exposures. The next step was using more modern technologies of analyzing the microbial context, 16S RNA sequencing, and from biosamples, from dust samples, from hay samples collected in these tables, and then to associate the presence of certain microbial species to this protective effect. So again, on a statistical fashion. And this is actually part of a shortlist, of a current shortlist of protective microbes which are present in these environmental situations and associated to certain health outcomes like physician-diagnosed asthma or atopic sensitization. And among this shortlist is one particular bacterium, Acinetobacter lofii, which gained recently lots of attention for several reasons. First of all, the load of exposure to this bacterium is very, very high. Secondly, this is again a gram-negative bacterium expressing also certain variants of endotoxin, of LPS. And thirdly, this is an apathogenic bacterium. An apathogenic bacterium present, abundantly present in the environment in these particular settings, but also here outside, maybe in the gardens and in the forests and in the natural environment. We see lots of Acinetobacter lofii exposure of this particular apathogenic bacterium. And in order to establish a cause-effect relationship of these more clinical and epidemiological observations, we are then moving it into mouse models of experimental asthma. And this slide just summarizes a couple of experiments we did with certain candidate strains. You see here a couple of candidate strains, which you saw already on the previous slide. Acinetobacter lofii is a gram-negative bacterium. Staphylococcus cheuri, Lactococcus lactis, Bacillus lichiniformis, and so on, gram-positive bacteria. So we take one after the other of these bacterial strains into conventional mouse models of experimental asthma. And first of all, yes, we could demonstrate that if we do that before sensitization and allergen challenge, before the induction of the clinical phenotype, yes, all of these bacteria can provide protection. When we give these bacteria through the natural route by inhalation or intranasal application. But very strikingly, the underlying mechanisms of these protections differ to some degree from strain to strain. As a common theme among these different strains, we always observe the induction of Th1-type immune responses together with interferon gamma. The interferon gamma signal is one of the strongest signals which we observe in all of these different protective models. And as a next step, we then try to mimic this situation of this farming environment, where we see that the prenatal exposure to these bacteria seems to play a very important role in order to provide protective signals to the next generation. And we used now this model bacterium, Acinetobacter loffii F78, which is an original isolate from one of these farming farms in the Alps. We give this bacterium every other day, starting before mating, continuing through pregnancy, intranasally every other day to the mother, and then we observe the phenotype of the offspring mice later on by inducing applying just a conventional protocol of allergen sensitization and airway allergen challenges. And to make a long story short, yes, this prenatal exposure has a very strong protective effect on the development of a phenotype in the next generation. And this protective effect can be picked up by several readouts, including mucus production, airway inflammation, particularly with eosinophils, indicative of a Th2-type immune response, or airway reactivity, airway responsiveness, the twitchiness of the airways, if you want to say so. So now what is happening here? How are these signals are being mediated and conveyed from one generation to the next one? First of all, what we could show is that these bacteria, when given intranasally, hitting the mucosal surface in the airways, are inducing an innate immune response. And this innate immune response is initiated in the airway epithelial layer is dependent on intact signaling through certain toll-like receptors. And this could be shown by a number of experiments. One experimental approach was to use so-called quintuple knockout animals deficient of TLR2, 3, 4, 7, and 9 simultaneously at the same time. And so these are basically toll-like receptor deficient mother mice, and the offsprings are completely normal. They can signal quite nicely through these pathways. But if the mother is deficient of this innate signaling pathways, then this protective effect is completely abrogated in the next generation. So there's now normal development of experimental asthma with mucus production, airway eosinophilia, and airway hyperresponsiveness. So this was the first important observation in this regard. So what is the consequence of this innate immune activation in the airways of the mothers? The consequence is the induction of a mild systemic pro-inflammatory response. So we see the induction of an inflammation, of a local inflammation, which can be picked up in the bronchoalveolar lavage fluid or in the serum, or in not only after acute exposures, but particularly also after chronic exposures. And this response consists of the production of IL-6, of TNF-alpha, and also of interleukin-1-beta. And this actually is a very important pro-inflammatory response, a very mild chronic inflammatory response, which is actually responsible for the mediation of this protective effect to the next generation, because IL-6 knockout mothers, again, cannot provide this protective effect to their offsprings. And this is a little bit, let's say, in contrast to the current view that chronic inflammation is something bad. Chronic inflammation, we have just heard the example of the development of type 2 diabetes, of the metabolic syndrome, where we consider currently chronic inflammation as a bad signal, as a signal which is involved in the development of a phenotype. So here we have a situation where we actually need a chronic, a mild, a subclinical pro-inflammatory response in order to provide a protective signal to the next generation. So the question now is, what is the consequence of this inflammatory response in the mothers in terms of providing the protective effect to the next generation? And of course, there are many interaction, many modes of interaction between the maternal immune system and the developing fetal environment, which includes the transmission actually and the transfer of maternal cells, of both T cells and dendritic cells into the fetal circulation. We can pick up these cells very readily in the fetal environment, but we don't know yet what they are actually doing. And a very important other mechanism is epigenetic regulation. We know that some of these microbes at least modulate the epigenetic program of CD4, but also non-CD4 positive T cells in early fetal programming. And this is something which is of great interest to us currently in the lab. So the second important concept which is being discussed recently is the microbiota hypothesis. So now we are moving from the external environment to the internal environment. And as we have heard in this last 3 days, there are lots of studies in many different diseases analyzing the composition of the endogenous microbiota, particularly in the gastrointestinal tract, in terms of the association with the development of clinical phenotypes. And this happens also in allergy and asthma. But when we look how this field stands currently, we have to conclude there are lots of inconsistent data, still inconsistent data from study to study, from cohort to cohort, and also from region to region. But one piece of data is consistent, and this is the issue again of diversity. Diversity in terms of the gastrointestinal flora. And what is very interesting is that this reduced diversity or dysbiosis can be picked up way early, way before the development of the clinical phenotype. And this is shown here on a couple of examples of recently published papers where the reduced diversity in later on allergic individuals could be demonstrated already within the first week of life or in the first month of life. And the development of the phenotype occurred in these particular prospective longitudinal studies way later in life. So that could indicate that there is actually a cause-effect relationship between the diversity or reduced diversity or the loss of certain microbial compounds and the development of clinical phenotypes. But much more work, of course, needs to be done in this regard. Another important piece of information is coming from cesarean delivery. And I really would like to stress about this particular issue because I think this is important not only for the development of allergy and asthma, but as has been recently shown, also associated with the development of type 1 diabetes. And if we look here for this, this is one of the recently published meta-analyses in this field, and the finding is very, very, very consistent that delivery by a cesarean section is associated with an increased risk, with an increased risk for the development of many phenotypes, including food allergy, eczema, and others. And this might be related to the diversity of the mother's body habitats. Because if we take this as an example, where the investigators actually compared the gut flora of babies born by cesarean section here on the right-hand side, with the flora at different body habitats of the mother, they found a very close correlation in many of these babies, which are born by cesarean section, between the gut flora of these babies at an age of 6 months or 1 year of life with the skin habitat of the individual mother, as you can see here by this color coding. And this is, of course, very much different from babies born by the vaginal route, where the vaginal route-born babies pick up the habitat from the mom's vagina, and these bacteria seem to provide the basis for the at least first the colonization of the baby's gut for the first few years in life. So the way how we are born seems to be decisive, at least for early colonization of the gastrointestinal tract. However, the cause-effect relationship in this regard also needs to be established in data studies. We don't know whether this is just a marker for something else going on, or whether really in this vaginal communities are certain bacterial communities which play a very important role in, might play a very important role in the development of the tolerance program in the next generation. And lastly, the third concept, which is now coming up recently in the literature and in this field, is the concept of the biodiversity. So this opens now the discussions away a little bit from the microbial situation as such towards the whole exposure to organic material in our lifestyle situation. And this is shown here. This is biodiversity. This little kid is sitting in the playground here on the grass and is exposed to many organic materials. And just as one last example in this regard, I would like to show you this study published by our Finnish colleagues around Tari Hatala, who took advantage of a community of about 120 adolescent individuals living in a very diverse region of 100 times 150 square kilometers in Finland, in eastern Finland. And what they did is they came up with a model of how exposure, in this case the land use type, urbanization, villages, or farming environment, the type of land use is associated with the development of the atopic phenotype, and they correlated this to skin microbiota. And what we found is that the land use type determines actually the production of IL-10. IL-10 is an anti-inflammatory cytokine, and that this is very closely related again to the exposure to Echinetobacter lofi. So this is another completely independent study coming up with the same bacteria, which I have shown you before as an important isolate from these traditional farming environments. So something seems to be quite unique with this particular strain of the gamma proteobacteria here. And this leads us now to focus more on gamma proteobacteria and to see what is unique with these particular strains and how they may be involved in the regulation of early inflammatory responses in life. And with that, I would to summarize this particular model, which I have taken from Charles Weddington, who actually introduced the concept of epigenetic regulation already 70 years ago. He was a geneticist working in New York, and he published this slide, I think, which illustrates the impact of many, many different environmental factors we are exposed to throughout our life, diets, toxins, allergens, microbes, and how we or our immune system needs to make the decision of how to respond in the appropriate way to these environmental exposures. And if we do that in the right fashion, then we may end up at the very end with a state of immunological tolerance. But if the decisions are made in the wrong way by epigenetic regulation, by environmental exposures, then we may increase the risk for the development of chronic inflammation. The future challenge is really to better understand these environmental factors in terms of the mechanisms, how they influence this early programming and early priming, with the goal to provide eventually new protective avenues in order to stop this epidemic of chronic inflammatory responses. And with that, I would like to thank particularly Holger Gahn in the lab and Petra Pfefferle, who are heavily involved in the human and the mouse work studies. And I would like to thank Erika Formutius, Susan Prescott, in particular Richard Blumberg, who is a collaborator in the field of gastrointestinal immunity. We would like to thank you for your attention.